Hey everyone, this will be straight and to the point. This video covers lighting tools in Blender. Not necessarily lighting techniques, but 7 different methods to add light to a Blender scene. I'll do my best to point out all the differences between Eevee and Cycles, and I'll sprinkle in some useful tips as we go. Like this one. Did you know that you can type in a negative value in the strength of a light in Blender, and the lamp will actually absorb light from the scene to make areas darker? Pretty cool. Okay, so let's get started. The main way to add light to a Blender scene is using lamps. There are 4 types of lamps in Blender, and each have different uses. They also have slightly different settings depending on whether we are using Cycles or Eevee. The Blender default scene includes 1 point lamp. To add a lamp to our scene, we hover in the 3D viewport and press Shift-A. Go down in the options and find lights. It'll give us the 4 types of lamps that we can add: point, sun, spot, and area. Let's talk about point lamps first, but in this section we are going to cover a lot of the basic settings that will apply to all the lamp types, so I recommend not skipping this part. Point lamps are one of the most useful and realistic lighting tools in Blender. The light starts at a point and emits in all directions. The light dissipates in strength the farther it travels. This dissipation is known as falloff, and you'll hear falloff mentioned quite a bit in this tutorial. Point lamps work in both of Blender's main render engines, Eevee and Cycles. Light will always be more realistic in Cycles, but Eevee is much faster at rendering, so pick your poison. The point lamp itself looks like this little sphere with a line coming down. The downward line doesn't mean anything, and the lamp itself will not appear when you render, just the light that it puts off. There is no edit mode with lamps, so pressing Tab with the light selected won't do anything. We access a lamp's controls in the Properties panel. When a lamp is selected, the Light Properties panel will appear as an option in the Properties panel. Here are the settings for the light that is currently selected. If we have multiple lights and select a different light, then the settings shown will be for the newly selected lamp. Lights are a specific type of object in Blender, and like all objects, can be renamed. So let's rename this light to something that we'll remember. That works. Notice at the top of the settings, we can change the light type easily by just clicking Sun, Spot, or Area. The lamp changes to the chosen type. A small warning though, with some advanced uses of lamps, specifically with fog in a scene, there have been issues when you create one type of light and then change it to another type of lamp. In general, try to add the type of light you actually want to use. For all types of lamps in both Eevee and Cycles, we can choose a color for the light that is emitted. We can see either a power or strength setting in all lamp types, and this is how strong the light is. As I showed you earlier, you can actually type in a negative value to have the lamp absorb light instead of adding it to your scene. These are the lamp settings in Eevee. These 3 settings affect how the light interacts with different types of surfaces. In Eevee, we have the option to give the lamp a custom distance. This distance is how far the light will shine. This is handy, but not entirely realistic. Real lights in the real world don't just hit an imaginary distance and then stop. Up here is the radius, and this setting will be found on most lamps. It's the size of the actual emitter, the light object itself. Even though you don't see the lamp when it's rendered, its size has a big effect on the shadows cast by its light. A small light will cast very sharp shadows with clear edges. A larger light radius will cast softer shadows, so the radius is an important setting. In Eevee, we can turn shadows on and off and have a few more settings to play with down here. But let's see what these settings look like when we switch to the more realistic Cycles render engine. We see the settings are clearly different, and in Cycles it appears to have fewer options. The color, power, and radius are the same as before. So Cycles is a ray tracing render engine, which means it traces the path of each light source. This max bounce setting you probably never have to touch, but reducing it will make the light slightly less realistic, but may improve rendering times by a tiny bit. But again, this is not all that important right now. Shadow caustics are a new feature in Blender. In short, this can add realism to how the light works with things like water. An important difference here in Cycles is the button to turn on Use Nodes. If we turn this on, the light will use nodes, and we'll see some more options appear. Then with the light selected, we can actually go into the shader editor and use nodes to create more intricate lighting setups, pretty much the same way we set up materials in Blender. One more thing about all types of lamps is we can control some visibility settings in the Object Properties panel by going down to the Visibility tab. Here, under Ray Visibility, we control how the light's rays interact with different parts of our scene. For example, whether the light rays will affect diffuse surfaces or glossy surfaces. And by unchecking transmission, the light won't shine through transmissive or transparent materials. Now let's look at the second type of lamp, the sun lamp. A sun lamp in Blender is different from a point lamp in that it shines in a specific direction and has no falloff. As the name implies, it simulates having sunlight in the scene, and because the real-world sun is so far away from Earth and it's so powerful, we don't actually notice the falloff from its light. So the sun lamp's light will be equally strong no matter how far away objects are from it. Because of that, the location of the light actually does not matter at all. No matter where it is in a scene, light will be shown across the entire scene. The sun lamp's direction does matter. This is a good time to point out that since lamps are objects, they move and rotate the same way as other objects. G is the shortcut to move the lamp. R is the shortcut to rotate the lamp. Tapping R twice will put it into a trackball rotation. The size of a sun lamp also doesn't matter. So if we go to our light properties in Eevee, we see settings familiar from the point lamp. Instead of a radius, there is an angle setting to manually change the angle. In cycles, the settings are also pretty much the same as they were for a point lamp. The third type of lamp in Blender is a spot lamp, which is probably pretty easy to imagine. It's a lamp that shines light in a cone shape that can be pointed in a specific direction. Like a point lamp, and unlike the sun lamp, the light does have falloff, so it dissipates the farther it gets away from the source. The spot lamp enters a scene pointing straight down, but like other lamps and objects in Blender, it can be rotated. Here's one of those handy tips I promised you at the beginning. This works with all types of lights, actually. With the light selected, press Shift and T on the keyboard, and then we can use our cursor to point or aim the lamp in our scene. This saves me tons of time aiming lights. When we have the light pointed how we want it, left-click to lock it in place. The settings for the spot lamp will mostly look familiar with the addition of settings for the spot shape. We have a size setting that's in degrees. This controls how wide the cone shape is for the spotlight. Then we have the blend setting. This tells Blender how sharp we want the light to be at the edges. A blend of 0 will make the light's cone very sharp and clearly defined. Increasing the blend amount will increase the area in which the light is blended into its surrounding. It will soften the hard edges of the spotlight. The Show Cone checkbox just allows us to better visualize the cone of the light. This cone won't actually appear in the render. The differences in settings between Eevee and Cycles are the same as they were with the other lamps. Let's look at the last lamp type, and that's the area light, and this one has some pretty cool uses. Area lamps are planes that emit light. They can simulate light diffusers that you see in studios. In many scenes, these may be better options than point or spotlights, but it depends on what you're going to use them for. Often the area lamp will be out of view of the camera and shining light into the scene. In the properties panel, we again see the basic settings, but for this one we can choose different shapes of the lamp. The options include square, rectangle, disc, and ellipse. More than with any other lamp, the size of the area lamp matters quite a bit. We can adjust it here, or we can do it in the 3D viewport with a shortcut S. And this is just like we do with any other object. Again, we can use the handy Shift-T shortcut to aim the light and left-click when we want to lock it in place. In Cycles, but not in Eevee, we have this beam shape area with a spread setting, which can be very useful for a few different things. It's similar to the blend setting with spot lamps. The default spread for the area lamp is 180 degrees, which shines the light very broadly into an area. As we decrease the spread, the light becomes much more defined. Bringing it all the way down to 1 degree makes the light shine perfectly straight from the shape of the lamp. This can look really cool when you're trying to get God rays through fog, and can be an alternative to spot lamps, depending on what effect you're going for. Although we can use nodes for any types of lamps in Blender, I find them most useful with these area lights and when the spread is turned way down. With the lamp selected, we go into the shader editor and we see an emission node plugged into a light output node. Well, here's what happens when we plug a Musgrave texture into the strength socket. We can also plug things into the color socket. In this situation, we could animate parts of this. There are just a lot of cool things we can do whenever nodes are involved. Okay, so those are the four types of lamps, but I have a few more lighting tools to cover. I'd like to take just a second and ask if this video has been helpful so far, that you hit the like button and consider subscribing to the channel. Thank you so much. The next lighting tool is very powerful, and that is the use of HDRIs to light a scene. I have an entire video dedicated to HDRIs, but we'll cover the basics quickly. HDRI stands for High Dynamic Range Image. These are images formatted a specific way so that they work as replacements for our world backgrounds. When placed into a scene, HDRIs can be used both for lighting a scene, or as the background of a scene, or for both. There are many places to get HDRI files. Polyhaven is the one I would start with. They are completely free. HDRIs can come in very high resolutions and a few different file types. Once we download one, we go into the shader editor. In the top left, change from object to world so we can edit the nodes of our world output. We'll see a background node plugged into a world output node. We can search for an environment texture node and add it to the setup. Plug its color output into the background color input. Click open and search for our HDRI file. Once it's loaded, it will be our background and the image will light the scene pretty realistically. These are especially good for outdoor scenes where in the real world we have light really coming from every direction. We can increase or decrease the strength right here. So those are HDRIs. Check out my full video on them if you want to learn more. The next thing to cover are IES lights. These are unfortunately only available to be used in cycles. IES files are very tiny files that tell a lamp in 3D software how to emit light. They're designed to simulate real-world light fixtures, and there are thousands of them available for free at ieslibrary.com. Download one of the files you want to use and add a point lamp in our scene. With the point lamp selected, go to the light properties panel. Remember, we have to be in cycles, and then turn on the use nodes. Now go into the shader editor, press Shift A to add a node, and search for an IES texture node. Plug its output into the strength input here. Change from internal to external, and click the file browser icon to search for our IES light file. Once it's loaded, our lamp will emit light in the way that the IES file tells it to. We'll probably need to turn the strength down quite a bit, which can be done with the strength slider here. I also have a full video on how to use IES lights in Blender. The final way I want to cover for adding light to a scene is through emissive materials. With these, any object can serve as a lamp, or we can have certain parts of an object put off light into a scene. If we select an object and add a material to it in the Material Properties panel, there are a few ways to make it an emissive material. We can actually use the default principled BSDF shader. We can control this shader either here in the Properties panel or inside the shader editor using the nodes. Down toward the bottom of its settings, the principled BSDF shader allows us to give the material an emission color. This will be the color of the light. And then we can adjust the strength of the emission just as we would with a lamp. The best part of this is it can be used for different parts of a mesh to make only certain parts of it emissive. We could get even more complex and use masks and combine the emission with other shaders. Another simpler shader that can do the same thing is the emission shader. We can change from the principled BSDF shader to the emission shader, and this shader only includes the settings necessary to make the material emissive. The exact same effect can be achieved with this shader. If you're new to materials, I have a two-part material series meant for absolute beginners, and I've gotten some really good feedback on it. So if you're interested, I'll put a link to it. We've covered the four types of lamps: HDRIs, IES lighting, and emissive materials in Blender. One fairly new feature in Blender that I should mention is light groups. This is a way to group lights and have their light be adjustable in the compositor. I'm not going to get into that, but I want you to know that this is a great tool for adjusting lights after you render an image. I'll link to a good tutorial on light groups in the description. So that's probably a good place to start, but of course there are add-ons that can help with lighting a scene, and there are a lot of courses available for lighting concepts and techniques. I've got a page on brandonsdrawings.com that I'll link to in the description with my favorite paid and free add-ons for Blender, as well as Udemy courses that I can recommend. I update these pages regularly whenever I find new things. I hope this video helped. My name is Brandon, and I'm just a guy from California who likes to make things in Blender. Please consider hitting that like button, subscribing, and checking out my website at brandonsdrawings.com. Thank you, and stay creative.